is considered to be as the first gospel? Probably kung 60 si Matthew. Hey, do you notice something? Jesus ministered at the age of 30 to 33. 33, he died. Diba? Kaya yung mga young daw talaga, mga great men, namamatay ng young yan, you know? Yan din si Alexander the Great, eh, diba? So after 3 years of ministry, he died on the cross. Do you notice na yung mga sinabi ni Jesus from 30 to 33, sinulat after 30 years uli? Do you think they were able to remember? How do they keep the teaching of Jesus, the words of Jesus? Oral. Kwinikwento nila ng kwinikwento. Paulit-ulit nilang sinasaysay yung kasaysayan at ministry ni Jesus. So the Gospel of Mark, probably ito ang pinaka-early. Probably ang taya ng iba dito is the late 40s. Late 40s or early 50s. Ang best nga is 49 to 50. 49 to 51. May available na yung Gospel of Mark is already available. Nakasulat na. Pero napaka-early nung theology ni Mark. Ano? Mark suggested by two early writers. Ang author niyan si Mark. Who is this Mark? Mark is not part of the 12. He is not one of the 12. How come he was able to write the Gospel? Because of, probably nga, Mark based his preaching, his writing from the preaching of Paul. But Paul preached when? Heavily, ano? Mukhang may source talaga si Mark tungkol sa life ni Jesus. Probably si Mark ay heavily depended on the preaching of Peter. But this Mark is also, along the way, naging kapartner din ni Apostle Paul. But Mark heavily depended on the preaching of Peter. Sinulat ito sa, ang Mark Gospel sinulat sa Rome. Yes, the Gospel of Mark was written in Rome, the provenance. So the place of writing is Rome. It could be early 50s or late 50s. Medyo mas early ang tayo natin dyan. The audience, compared to Matthew, na ang audience ni Matthew ay Palestinian Jews o Jewish community na mayayaman, the Gospel of Mark, ang kanyang audience ay Gentile Christians who are probably living in Rome. These are Gentile Christians. And his purpose is to introduce to his readers who Jesus is and to be aware of the Gospel of Salvation through Jesus Christ. Dito, kung ang purpose ni Matthew is to present Jesus as the Christ, the fulfillment of the Old Testament promise or prophecy, Mark, the purpose of Mark is to let these people, the Gentile readers, to be aware of the salvation available through the Son of God, Jesus Christ. And you will notice sa Gospel ni Mark, nakapokus siya sa lagi doon sa mga yung sa mga exorcism. Napansin niyo ba na ang Gospel of Mark ay focus doon sa mga pagpapalayas ng mga demons, yung mga bad spirits, at mukhang siya talaga, nakapokus sa exorcism. So that's, remember that the Gospels, including the Book of Acts, so these are the historical books of the New Testament. Gospels to Acts. These are narratives. So the Gospels, it records, the Gospel records the life and ministry of Jesus. When we say his ministry, his deeds. These are the works, the works, the works or deeds. The works or deeds of Jesus. When we say the ministry of Jesus, so the gospel up to the book of Acts are considered to be the historical books of the New Testament. They are called narratives. The genre is narratives. These are narratives. However, it differs because the book of Acts is different from the gospel or the gospel. So we are now in the gospel of Luke. Just put it in your note. The gospel of Luke is considered to be the longest among the gospels. Though it is only 24 chapters, but in terms of the volumes, it is considered to be the longest among the gospels. It is written by by Luke. Again, he is not one of the 12. Si Luke ay hindi kasama sa 12 apostles. Luke is a disciple of Peter and Paul also. The place of writing, ang considerable place is Achaia. Again, probably he wrote in the early 60s or within 60s ang writings ng Gospel of Luke. Let's visit the Gospel of Luke. Tignan natin yung kanyang introduction sa chapter 1. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. Please, kindly read chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. Sino na ba yun? Saan na? Dito na, no? Dito na yata sa gawing ito. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 3 of the Gospel of Luke. Chapter 1, Luke chapter 1, 1 to 3, please. Let's see how Luke started this letter. Okay. Okay, the Gospel of Luke. So the Gospel of Luke, the author is no other than Luke, the physician. You will notice that the background of the author is coming from a medical practitioner because you will notice the terminologies. He is very much focused on the issue of the poor. Seemingly, Luke's concern is the marginalized member of the society. He is concerned to the people who are economically and physically marginalized. They are those who are sick. They are those who are poor in terms of their financial or economic life. That's how he presented Jesus. Seemingly, in the presentation of Luke, Jesus is pro-poor. Mukhang mas nagpapamember si Jesus sa poor society. He identifies himself with the poor. In fact, in the record, he introduced Jesus, the Son of God, as someone who was born in a manger. Yun yung kanyang pagpapakilala kay Jesus. Pinanganak si Jesus sa sabsaban. At yun, nag-i-image pa lang na si Jesus talaga ay mukhang, sa kanyang pagtingin, ay mukhang makamahirap at concern sa mga issue ng mga mahihirap. Kaya yung Sermon on the Mount ni Matthew, pagdating kay Luke, wala nang spirit. Dinerecho niya na, blessed are the poor. Kay Matthew, blessed are the poor in spirit. Kay Luke, blessed are the poor. the economically poor. Yung poor talaga ang kanyang concern. At siyempre, pag tinignan mo, kahit sila Saint Francis de Assisi, he developed his strategies on that particular method, ano, that Jesus is a poor, and therefore he developed the spirituality of Saint Francis as the doctrine and the practice of poverty and simplicity, the humility of Saint Francis de Assisi. Si Luke, so nagsulat siya, no, probably 60s. Ang best dating ng gospel ng Luke ay 60s. Pero ang concern niya, the marginalized members of the society. To whom it was written? It was written to Theophilus. The problem is that how come, who is this Theophilus? Why Luke wrote his gospel to Theophilus? Who is this Theophilus? There are two interpretations. There are scholars who insist that this Theophilus is symbolical. Because Theo means God, and Philus means Phileo, love. So, ito, the first proposal of the scholars is that the Theophilus is symbolical. It means lovers of, it was written to the people who are lovers of God. Okay, but that is not the agreement of the conservative scholars. They believe that Theophilus is a real person. And seemingly, that person is the one paying for the cost of his writing. Siya yung kanyang ano, patron na tagabayad ng kanyang pagsusulat, yung gumagastos. At alam nyo naman, uso yan noong old century, ano, na somebody is paying for your work, like the work of the Septuagint. It was translated into Greek. The Old Testament Hebrew Bible was translated into Greek sa expense ni ano, ng King of Egypt. Kasi gusto nilang makita dahil noon, mahalaga sa kanila yung mga law. At nakapattern nga yung Ten Commandments natin ng Bible, nakapattern siya sa Hammurabi's law. The same format. Kung titingnan mo, hindi talaga law yung Ten Commandments, di ba? Kung titingnan natin sa Tagalog, saway siya, saway. Kasi thou shall not. Ang law dapat positive. It commands. Pero yung law, nakikita mo yung Ten Commandments, hindi siya utos eh. Pasaway siya, di ba? Pasaway. Sinasaway niya kasi negative siya, thou shall not, di ba? So, we believe that Theophilus is a real person. Not symbolical. The meaning. Okay. Why Luke wrote his gospel to Theophilus? Does it mean that yung gospel ay for the eyes only of Theophilus? Hindi. Basically, it was written by Luke for the wider audience, a community. But he is saying that the best reader probably is Theophilus, na mayaman si Theophilus, kaya nga siyang bayaran eh. Kayang ipinance yung kanyang writing. At mukhang si Theophilus ay ginamit sa Book of Acts, sa chapter 23, in the Book of Acts, iyan yung Festus, dalawang governors ang ginamitan niyan. Mukhang it is the governor. The Theophilus is one of the governors during that time who wanted to have a complete story, a complete narrative of who Jesus is. And therefore, napaka-strategic ng Gospel of Luke na pinakita ni Luke kay Festus, kay Theophilus, na dapat concerned siya sa poor. Do you see the logic? And here is Theophilus, who seems to be the governor. And he is asking for the complete narrative of who Jesus is and his ministry. And strategically, Luke was able to present to Theophilus that Jesus is concerned for the poor. And therefore, the governor must be concerned for the poor. If you really love God, you must love the poor. That is the strategy of Luke. So, isang notice na tatandaan nyo lagi yan. Isang note na dapat nyo tandaan. The Gospel of Luke presented Jesus, someone who is pro-poor. concern to the marginalized member of the society. The fact that the record says that Jesus was born in a manger, not in the temple. Alam niyo na yun, ano yung mga message ng Christmas Day, why Jesus decided to be born in a manger, not in a temple. Eh dapat, ano siya, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Bakit siya sa manger pinanganak? Iyon yung pagkukwento, yung narratives, ano. At mukhang, realizing and analyzing chapter 1, verses 1 to 3, seemingly, what Luke is saying, nung nagsulat siya, may mga nabasa na siya, no? I have carefully investigated those who have already come up with the accounts. So mukhang available na yung Matthew at saka yung Mark. Nabasa niya na. But seemingly, hindi gusto ni Luke yung presentation dahil makamayaman yung presentation at masyadong nakapokus sa mga exorcism yung kay Mark. So nagpresent siya ng gospel na si Jesus, ang image ay someone who is pro-poor. At mukhang kailangan natin yung sa ganitong society, ano? Na that Jesus is willing to be identified with the poor. At to be honest with you, ang Catholic side, masyado silang makamatean, makamatthew at saka mga makaluke. Mas tinitingnan nila yung Lucan perspective ng ministry ni Jesus na you should help the poor, you must have the heart for the poor. If you really love God, you must love those who are poor. Compared to Matthew, si Matthew, nagpakita naman si Jesus doon ng image na sabi ni Jesus, this is what will happen on the judgment day. He will gather the in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, you know, He will gather the 24 or 25. He will gather the righteous on his right and the wicked on his left. And then the king will say to him, which is Jesus, sabi niya dun sa mga righteous na nasa right side, hindi kayo wicked ah. Sabi ni Jesus nung king, so Matayan perspective. There was a time that I was hungry, you give me food. I am thirsty, you give me water. I was in prison, you visited me. I was naked, you clothed me. And then the righteous will say, Lord, kailan namin ginawa yan? Sabi ni Jesus sa kanila, when you did it to the least, you did it to me. Seemingly, Matthew is telling his audience, his reader, that they should take care of the poor. Dahil mayaman nga sila eh. So, well, strategic yung matay yan, di ba? Tapos sabi niya sa left, you, there was a time that I was hungry, I was naked. Lahat, yung nasa kabila na sinabi. Kailan namin hindi ginawa yan sa inyo? Sabi ng mga wicked. When you deny it to the least of the member of the society, you deny it to me. O, ayun. Kaya makita nyo, yung evangelist na dalawang ito, mayroon silang kani-kanilang strategy how they will present Jesus according to the needs of their readers. So, hindi sila nagsulat ng empty mind. Nagsulat sila strategically and intellectually. They are aware of the needs of their readers.